Hello, everybody. Welcome to tonight's stream at the Art Lounge Alley. Tonight, I have a special intro for you. It is of a new favorite illustrator animator named Steve Kutz. It's another really cool animation that he's done. So I'm not going to spend too much time talking about it. I am just going to play it for you guys. So that was it, everybody. It's actually one of my favorite animations now. It's one of his older works. I'm going to say it was made 5 years ago. But since today is a special day, it's actually a celebration of hitting 300 subscribers on YouTube. So I'm really happy about that. Thank you guys for that support. I really appreciate it. I'm happy to see that you guys are enjoying the content. So today is going to be a double feature to celebrate that. I'm going to show you guys another one right after this. I just wanted to talk about that real quick. You know, it was something I was talking about yesterday. You know, the idea of seeing it from a different perspective. You know, I think this is kind of like a general idea about man and him coming to existence. But I think what really highlights this is the idea of a capitalist man. You know, this is all done through capitalism, through the idea of the Industrial Revolution and the change that took place. And with that change came all these catastrophes, you know, at the hands of people who consider themselves capitalists. They don't care for anything other than themselves, and they'll, you know, stomp and destroy whatever for the sake of more capital. But I think as a general idea, as the way that Steve Kutz presents it as man, it's basically saying that it's your responsibility to choose wisely, you know, as a man, going forward, really. So not to sort of, you know, shift the blame and say, oh, it's just capitalists, and then really not pay attention to your own actions and behaviors. You know, I don't consider myself to be a capitalist. I don't do any of those things, but not really focusing on the choices that we make, you know, the things that we support. So we have just as much influence on whether it continues to escalate as the way that you saw it here, you know, by the choices that we make and what we support and what we do, really. So I think that was his message, basically, despite it really being clearly about more of a capitalist man than just an everyday man. Anyways, so that's my kind of two cents about it. I'll talk about it maybe a little bit further after. But as I was mentioning, I wanted to celebrate today by having a double feature. So this is going to be also a Steve Kutz animation. It's actually more recent, so you're going to see better animation there. And it's beautiful. I think the way that he chose camera angles, the cinematography there, I think is really cool. And I hope you guys enjoy it. Well, that was it, everybody. I hope you enjoyed that as much as I did. Absolutely love Steve Cutts' animation. You know, it was just something that I came across by accident. I watched it. I was like, oh, this is perfect. This is just the kind of material that is fit for the Art Lounge Alley. So I was glad I was able to share that with you guys. And as you could see, the animation has really, really improved. I mean, he combined everything there. He had kind of like 3D rendering with 2D, and I kind of like how his animation is very similar to like 1920s cartoons. So it's like a little bit of that combined with like modern illustrations. Very unique style. Really, really enjoyed it. And the subject matter is pretty much the same as the previous one. I just wanted to show you guys the first one, since I was talking about, you know, just kind of seeing it in different perspective. It doesn't necessarily have to be exactly as the artist intended. I think it's fun to look at art and try to come up with your own interpretation, you know. Exercise your imagination, exercise your creativity. It's great to do both, you know, to understand the message coming from the artists themselves, and also coming up with your own idea, you know, something that sparked your creativity or your perspective, you know, your individualistic perception. So that's one of the special streams amongst the many to come. I actually came across another idea for a special stream today. You know, I was looking through some stuff. I was like, oh, this is also excellent. This should be a lot of fun. So make sure you check back in with the Art Lounge Alley to see future special streams that are coming. There's another one that's coming this Friday. It's going to be a continuation of Gil Elfgren and his influences. It's going to be part 8. So I'm pretty happy about that as well. I've been having such a great time just talking about all these artists, exploring their work, sharing my thoughts on their painting, and giving you guys insight about the history for each and every one of these artists and their involvement in the illustration world and how much influence they've had throughout up until modern day. You know, I'm seeing even like modern day artists who are having influences based on design coming from Landecker. J.C. Landecker, which is the last artist that I stopped at the previous special intro last Friday. You guys can always catch up on the previous Gil Elfgren streams by heading over to the video section on Twitch and filtering it based on collection, which is going to open up all sorts of folders for you. And yeah, you could catch up there. You could catch up on all the special streams, actually, not just Gil Elfgren, by following those steps. And there's gonna be a folder that's called Special Intros. I believe I just recently changed it. So that's something fun for you guys to do. Most of them are pretty short. I don't think I've had anything, well, aside from the Gil Elfgren special intros, I think for the rest of the special intros are pretty short. I do things like introduce you guys to new comics, other short films that you could check out, and yeah, there's a bunch. Can't really recollect all of them off the top of my head, but they're bound to be entertaining or interesting to some degree. So today I'm just continuing on with hands. Believe that's going to be for the rest of the week. You know, I'm just going to be filling up all these little areas. As you can see, I'm like barely squeezing it in this little section right here. But I hope to inspire you guys to do the same with your sketchbook. You know, don't waste the paper. Get used to really drawing all over. Bunching things up. You know, that's something that I think a lot of people starting out are shy to do. You know, I think the whole idea of like colliding images just seems blasphemous. Like, you shouldn't be doing that. But really, it's an excellent way to practice how to really fill up empty space. You know, so when it comes to things like anything, really, whether it's comics or if you want to do fine art, you know, if you want to work on canvases or whatever, it's going to require you to draw objects next to each other, to draw objects in the foreground and the background. And this kind of helps you get over that fear little by little. It's great to get yourself out of your comfort zone, because some people get used to drawing really small. You know, that's just where it's comfortable for them. So it's good to do the opposite of what you're comfortable with when it comes to drawing. I'm going to say when it comes to a lot of things, I'm going to say there are even a lot of instances in life itself, you know, outside of learning hobbies, you know, just your own personal struggles, whether it's psychological or physical or whatever. It's great to get out of your comfort zone and challenge yourself. That's where growth happens. That's where I think there are neurons in your brain that fire off and give you more of a healthy growing process. Is when you get out of your comfort zone, challenge yourself, you start thinking, start coming up with ideas, you start processing what's going on. It livens you up, is really where I'm getting at. So doing the opposite of what you're comfortable with, if you're not comfortable, for instance, going out and talking to people, you know, put in effort to do it. Go out and try to strike conversation with somebody by, like, I don't know, going to, let's say, a bookstore, your local bookstore, and find somebody there and ask them a bunch of questions, or somebody who's working there. You could ask them some questions about a book that you're looking for. You know, get comfortable with that. If you see somebody with a pet, ask if you could pet their pet, you know, their dog. Usually it's dogs. As a way of like interacting with people, getting over your phobia of, and getting more comfortable doing the opposite of what you're afraid of. I think it's important now, because there's a lot of people, I think even the younger generation, I'm gonna say, that kind of grew up in COVID times, where, you know, the whole idea of interaction sounded terrible. You didn't want to catch COVID, you didn't want to be around people, you don't want to. And then how people started acting during COVID, it was insane. So I'm sure that it unmotivated a lot of people from interacting, and I think we kind of have to start stepping back into it for multiple reasons, because, and I'm going to say one of the biggest reasons is because of how unhappy we are with things that are going on economically. You know, how abusive pretty much everything was during that time, including people that we've elected to make things better, but instead they were trying to exacerbate COVID, spreading false information, telling people to go back to work, and catching the virus for the sake of more profits. So we got to get more comfortable interacting with one another, banding together, and changing things. Because that was unbelievable. you know, I'm still to this day really pissed about it. And I hope you are too. But we need to band together. We need to start interacting with each other in a progressive way, coming up with ways and ideas to create this change. You know, provide people with livable wages so that people could actually enjoy themselves instead of being miserable all the time. Because that echoes through, as you guys have seen, people's actions and behaviors echoes through society. So we got a bunch of crazy people because of one person who was quote unquote popular ended up creating a lot of problems and enabling a lot of hate and violence and crazy behavior. And that rippled through. You know, so we got to start coming up with ways to get these people out. They're not doing their job. They're just abusing our taxes. They're abusing our efforts, our work, so that they could stuff their pockets more. So yeah, just basically saying we got to get over some of our phobias, you know, get more comfortable interacting with one another. Getting comfortable with rejection, you know, if things don't go out right, you know, maybe even do that, you know, rather than trying to gain what you want to gain, go out and get comfortable with rejection, you know, as a way of exercising yourself, right? Just like exercising your psychological strength. Interact with people, try things. And just kind of go with it, you know, accept that it's going to fail or it's going to be bad or whatever it is. You're going to be embarrassed and realize, like, that's my goal. I want to be okay with that. I don't want to be shackled by it and fear it. You know, I want to get past it. All right, so more hand examples there. I don't know if I could fit anything else. Maybe like a really small one. Maybe like this in this little section right here. I'm going to take that challenge. I'm going to do it. So I'm going to start out like I usually instruct you guys to use basic shapes. So this is like an in-between, you know, of like, I don't know, I'm going to say it's like a loaf of bread or a burrito. You know, I'm just using that as a placeholder for fingers. And you guys are going to slowly see how this is going to transform into actual fingers. I'm going to use like a circle for the palm. And then from there, I'm just going to connect these two shapes. I'm going to cut that burrito. And now I'm just going to start slowly forming it. Now, I'm not taking the box approach. Now, remember, that's a tool to get a better understanding of whatever it is that you're studying, whether it's hands, whether it's the head, whether it's the body. It's really there for you to be able to shape it properly in perspective and so on and so forth. So it's not something that you always have to do, but I highly encourage those who are learning, who are beginning, to use that. To use that as your guide, as your tool, to get better and better. I'm going to do more examples of that. Absolutely. You know, for me, it's always practice as well. I really enjoy it. Gives me a better understanding of whatever it is that I'm drawing as well. So I'm not opposed to doing more of those. But feel free to make comments about it. Let me know what you want to see more of, like which approach you want to get better examples on, visually, conversationally. And I'll be happy to show you guys more of those. I'm being really mindful of the nail, or just nails in general. I'm very mindful of them because like I've mentioned before, they're so important. You know, you could draw the most realistic hand, but if you don't get the perspective of the nail right, you know, if it takes up the entire finger, let's say, you don't leave any borders around, you know, this whole area is just the nail, you know, or if it's flat, it's not in perspective with the finger, instantly breaks the drawing. You immediately recognize something's off. Kind of work there. So once again, the approach of sketching things out, you know, just giving it this general shape to make sure that the parameters are set, that it's going to be within these shapes, within the size, the scale that you chose, proving itself to be a really effective approach. That's kind of one of the reasons why I did it, you know, aside from wanting to fill up the sketchbook as much as possible, also just to demonstrate to you guys that that's an excellent way to tackle a drawing. Sketch it out. And I've been doing it more with like personal projects as well, in general. Just creating thumbnails, and you'll see that with a lot of artists. It's not a textbook thing. You know, there is like a difference between just following orders and understanding why that's a common reality, or why that's a common approach. So something that I mention a lot is using basic shapes, using simple forms to construct your drawing, and that's because it's time saving. You know, if I was to start drawing this and going into really a lot of detail and so on and so forth, and then realize that it doesn't even fit, it's time wasted, effort wasted, you know, detail wasted. Whereas if I just approach it using, let's say, stick figures, right? Just making sure that I capture, let me do like a quick, can you guys see this? Yes. You know, quick gesture drawing showing the pose. And as you can see, I'm just using stick figure like, gestures. Well, now I just established, okay, this is what the pose is going to be like. This is the body language. This is where the arms are going to go. That's like a thumbnail. That's just showing these really basic sort of elements that I can take and like improve. You know, I can then start to give it more shape, add definition, add muscles. As you're slowly seeing me do that here, I'm not going to spend too much time on it, but you get the idea. You know, so I didn't go too much into detail. I made sure that everything fits. I got the pose that I wanted. And now I could take this, you know, once you've done that, now you could take it and do something more detailed. You established all those things. You might want to spend more time sketching things out. You might not like it, the pose, or you might want to like tweak some things off of that, you know, so it's small. You don't have to take up much space. Again, you're not really devoting too much time and attention. It's just to get a grasp of where you want to go with it. You know, what sort of action do you want to give it? What sort of energy does the figure have? So the simple approach that started out with just a stick figure. So for those of you who are like, I just know how to draw stick figures. Well, good news. You're actually doing great. You're actually learning or doing something that's incredibly useful, even to advanced artists. You'll see people who are well in the game still choosing that as a way of like, you know, warming up. You know, this is your appetizer before the main course sort of thing. So it's not just everybody does it, I gotta do that. It has its functionality that's really beneficial. You know, it has its I'm like enjoying this pose now. I'm like, how can I make it look even better? It has its functionality and has its like very specific purpose. I highly encourage you guys to play around with that yourselves. You know, get familiar with that. Take your stick figures to the next level. You know, really do something with it. And the more you'll progress, the more if you get projects, it's going to be a great way for you to be able to brainstorm ideas. You know, not feeling intimidated of like, oh, I'm just going to jump in immediately and try to produce something like this. Let's see. I'm kind of staring at this right now. I'm thinking, what can I do? I want to do something with this shape here, and I think I can fit like another small hand. Just making sure I'm not going over time here, because I do want to get to coloring comics, which is coming up next. Pretty excited about it. It is something that I'm only doing once a week, so when it comes around, I'm like, oh, nice, you know, to switch. Focus switch. So yeah, once again, using this like general shape kind of. And after a while, you become so, I think, accustomed to drawing shapes that you start fusing them, like a square and a circle. You know, there are certain elements that you start using as a way of constructing your general shape. It's kind of like it's kind of like reading as well. I'm gonna say, like, the more words you know, the more adventurous you want to get with using them, or reading more complicated context. You know, it's just the natural progression of learning something and getting more comfortable with it. So similar here, it's like you get comfortable with drawing basic shapes, you learn them, and now you feel like, oh, I could change things around a little bit. I could shift this. I could stretch this, you know, and still attain the goal that you're working on. So here, if you notice, this is an important detail. This is part of the do and don't drawings that I was doing last week, which is, should I bring this up? Why not? I'm gonna switch it up a little bit. do a little review. I didn't spend too many times reviewing it, so it should be a good one right after I finish this drawing, though. I'm not gonna hop around too much. And I do want to talk a little bit about those, the last animation by Steve Kutz, or rather his newest out of the two. So much to do, so little time. I'm okay with drawing all over this page. You know, at some point I'm gonna wanna upload some of these pages for you guys on Patreon. But I'm okay with this one because it didn't really turn out too great. Like, I think here, I just spent too much time on this eye and it just, it got damaged. Like, the paper got damaged, rather, because I was spending too much time correcting it and getting it right. So I'm not really happy with the results. If anything, if I'm ever gonna upload this specific drawing, I'm just gonna redo it for you guys. But the other ones turned out pretty good. The lesson about shading, and how shadows form on the face. That's something that I also covered some time ago. I don't know, it's been about a month probably since I talked about it. I don't exactly remember. Alright, so let me just go back. Hold on, let me just get this in there. And I'm gonna go back to the do's and don'ts I talked about last week. I feel like it's a good recap. I'm gonna utilize the foreground background concept. This is behind this little bust, the silhouette. So I'm going to be uploading that, the stream tonight, and you guys will have a chance to rewatch the special intros, because there's so many cool elements in his animations and his drawings. Like, if you just go back and pay attention to some of the detail, especially in the second one, there's some funny scenes there, funny little details. You know, with him, it's more than just the message. Like, it's also within his work, and I really, what inspired me also to do the double feature was just seeing that new one. It's like relatively new, I'm gonna say. I don't know if it was like done 2 years ago. But definitely in comparison to the first one. That first one was done back in 2015 or 17, one of those. So it has quite some age on there. And you could just drastically see the difference in animation. But yeah, he always adds little things there for you guys to pay attention to if you watch the animations all over again. It's really fun. Now, same thing was the case for the other special intro with his work, Happiness, where it's like a rat race. If you guys go back to that one, which is also uploaded in the special streams folder, and rewatch that and pay attention to little details, you could find some funny, funny drawings, funny animations. Okay, let's go back to do's and don'ts for a minute. And this is about hands. Taking me longer than it should to find it. I know it's here somewhere. This is like the problem with working on old sketchbooks, is that all this stuff is just all over the place. I'm just going based off of where there's more space. Where are you, do's and don'ts? Somewhere. I should probably fold it for the future. Oh, come on. There you go. And somewhere there. Okay, so here are the do's and don'ts. It's all about hands. So do construct using the block form, as you could see here. It's excellent for things like nails, for example. Once you establish the plane, you know, for those of you who are just tuning in, planes would be like, this would be a plane. Surface areas that I'm going to say are kind of flat, but form three dimension. So this would be a plane right here at the forehead, you know, this section right here. This would be a plane as well. I'm going to say this section is a plane. This side, entire side is, are planes. They're also planes. Here is a plane. You know, the side of the nose right here, that's a plane. The middle section is also a plane, and it's helpful. So like the way you're seeing it here, that's a plane right here, that's also a plane right here. On the side of the finger, that's also a plane. So all that just kind of helps you get a better understanding of the object or subject three-dimensionally, and that's going to help you construct it better. And get a stronger understanding of its of its shape, basically, of its proportions, of its anatomy and everything. So really useful for that. It's very useful for shading as well. Let's say you pick your light source, it's easier to imagine like what areas, since you have like this three-dimensional construction of the subject, what areas are going to receive light, what areas are going to be in shadow. So visually, it's a visual aid for that reason as well. So multiple purposes for it. Helps you construct it three-dimensionally, understand it fully. It helps you understand joints as well, like where are the certain, like as you could see that it's kind of divided, for you to know, okay, well, this is where the joint is, etc. Same thing here. It helps with perspective. So this hand being not directly facing towards the camera, it's to the side. And to have a good understanding of everything in its proper placement, in its proper size in relationship to other features, it's helpful to use this box form. Here we got a don't. So don't go into detail, you know, by just like immediately shaping everything out, spending a lot of time, because, for example, as you could see, the nail here is wrong. Whereas here, because you have the plane, you were able to place it in the right section. It's in perspective, you know, it's not directly towards the front, which is what this suggests. The fingers to the side, you know, there's no way in this perspective that your thumb is going to be this flat. You know, it's like, it's kind of like this, basically. Well, it looks very stiff, I'm going to say. It's not that it's impossible, but even in this position, you know, if you're facing the camera, I'm going to say it's like this. It's still pretty difficult for it to be that flat. It's still going to be in perspective, you know, depending on how you're seeing it. Yeah, even if you're looking at the camera now, you could see that it's to the side. It can't be like that. You know, that's really unnatural, considering also that it's not right up against the finger. You know, it's actually to the side. And since it's moving to the side, it's starting to take perspective. So the nail is wrong there. So is the nail on the index finger. Again, take a look. It's suggesting that the finger is like, the tip of the finger is like twisting. So wrong there as well. Same thing for this nail. So this really helps for multiple reasons, all the ones that I listed. And sketching things out like this creates this pitfall. You know, you're bound to just make the wrong decisions in terms of perspective, in terms of anatomy, in terms of relationships with the fingers, that sort of stuff. All right, let's move on to it. Do make sure that you create the proper corners for joints. You know, shape things out. Spend some time. Pay attention to these little details. You know, pay attention to areas where the joints kind of break and create like a different sort of line here, right? Whereas here, it kind of looks like a glove that's blown up, right? If you had like a plastic or rubber glove, rather, you blew it up, it turns into like a balloon shape. So these are like balloon fingers almost. There are no real edges there to define. There are no knuckles, nothing. Everything is rounded off. It looks worse than a cartoon. Just doesn't make much sense. But yeah, here you could see the line work is very much focused on detail. Where certain bones stick out, you know, that really adds to it. So the more characteristic lines you make, or the more character you give your lines, the more interesting and more captivating and more realistic and believable your drawing tends to be. All right, let's move on to the next one. This is a brief overview. I'm not going to spend too much time on it. You guys can always catch up on this in previous streams. The thumb, how it's moving. So that's a really important thing to notice, that this section is an addition. Like you could see, this whole area is an addition to the palm. You know, it doesn't just connect to the palm. Like the thumb doesn't just connect to the entire palm. There's this other section that is connected, which allows the thumb to move in and out. Whereas here, you know, don't do what I was just describing. Don't just use it as if though it's just this thing that's attached to a palm. you know, and notice that the motion of it being in then going out, there is no real shape like you see here. Kind of reminds me of like a chicken leg, I'm gonna say. I don't know. Anyway, so yeah, that's a do and don't when it comes to the thumb. This is similar. This is kind of similar to it, but not really. The main focus here is paying attention to the shape, the general shape of your fingers. So notice how it's kind of, it's an arch. You know, it's not really going straight across like you're seeing here. All the fingers aren't the same size, aside from the pinky being obviously the smallest one. There's variation to each finger, and because of that variation creates curvature. But not only is there curvature at the top, but there's also curvature at the base right here. So that's another detail to pay attention to. What you really want to do, and this is something I guess I haven't really spent much time talking about, is observe things. Really take the time and really try to grasp what they look like. Don't just draw, like I'm telling you guys, okay, this is an arch, you know, so you sit down, you always draw these arches. Draw from real life, you know, pay attention to hands and pay attention to all the little details that are on there, you know. So once again, the more character your lines have, the better you get at drawing, the better your line work gets, the more complex your lines get, and easier lines become a lot faster for you to draw. You know, you're not bothered by them anymore, in a sense. You're moving on to the next challenge. You're looking at all these intricate things. And through this idea of just like drawing based on observation, real focused, you know, take your time, observe the curvature to lines, the intricate little details. Through that, you gain more and more sensitivity to things. You know, that leads to more inspiration, that leads to more interesting line work, that leads to capturing little things. Like, as I was mentioning in the animations, there's some cool little hidden gems within the animations themselves that have a message as well, or something, you know, humorous or funny. But you tend to notice those things because you train your eye to be more sensitive to detail, to be more sensitive to things that are kind of hidden in between the bushes, you know. All right, so yeah, as you could see here, adding more curvature to the top, adding more curvature to the base, adding more curvature to the thumb as well. As you could see here, it's kind of like a popsicle stick. You know, it's really flat. The drawing is really flat, but once you start recognizing these little things, the hand comes alive almost. All right, so next and final one for this quick quote-unquote recap before I move on to, to coloring comics, is going to be here. This is the thumb. This is not the thumb. This is the hand. And again, it has to do with the knuckles, but it's very similar to this concept. Pay attention to the curvature. You know, even if you look at your own knuckles, notice that it doesn't just go straight across, right? I'm going to even hold it straight. And the first two knuckles are still at an angle. You know, this varies. You know, some people have more knuckle, I guess, but it's all slanted. It goes down. It doesn't just go straight across. It also curves because your hand isn't, you know, depending on the position of the fingers, you can't have them be in this position, but at the same time have all the knuckles be straight. You know, maybe if you hold the fingers out straight, that could seem to be more the case. But once you curve your fingers, you're already curving everything else on it. The palm itself is curved as well, visually. So this kind of just shows it, you know, add that curvature. Make sure you add the curvature to your knuckles. Don't just have them go straight across. It's not real. And it looks bad. It's going to break the drawing. It's going to break that fourth wall. All right, everybody. I hope you enjoyed this special intro. I hope you guys enjoyed tonight's stream. This is going to be it for figure drawing basics. I'm going to take a quick break, get ready for the next sesh, which is going to be coloring comics. I'm going to be coloring Conan the Barbarian panels. Can't wait to start that, and I hope I see you guys there. Hello, everybody. Welcome to tonight's stream of the Art Lounge Alley. I'm your host, and this is Coloring Comics. This is where I left off last time, which was last week. Coloring the cult meeting. So Conan finally got the opportunity to infiltrate the cult meeting, and unfortunately, he was discovered by the cult leader, who recognized that he didn't look familiar. He looked like a newcomer, and I guess he knew what Conan looked like, so pointed him out to all these other cult members, and we have yet to find out what happens next when it comes to Coloring Comics. So I'm going to start out. I'm going to be using this brush right here. It's zero, size zero. Found it to be pretty good. It does the job for pretty much everything. As you guys can see, I'm working small here, so kind of suits the need for broad strokes as well as detail. This is going to be a lot of green in this in this panel here, so let's see if I'm getting better at this mixture. I think I'm going to start exploring the approach. No, that's like, it's too green, I'm gonna say. I'm gonna add a little bit of water. Whoa. I'm gonna add more yellow. I'm gonna just see how they used to do it back in the day, because what they did was they would figure out the color. You know, they would pay attention to how they're mixing the color first. And once they find what they're looking for, they would just replicate that. Those steps, and then just create an entire vial full of that color. And I kind of like how all this blends. I really, really, really love India inks. I tried watercolor, and I'm not ruling it out. It's very challenging, I'll tell you that. Watercolor is very challenging. You get some amazing results, but what I don't like about it is that you need very specific paper. Like, you need paper that is really thick, because otherwise it's gonna warp. And I think that's the part that turns me off, because I use these sketchbooks and I like very specific type of paper. Like, I don't like rough paper. I don't like paper that has a lot of texture. I don't like how the pencil feels on that. So for me, it just wasn't as fun. But I'm not ruling it out. You know, I'm planning to come back to it. But I really, really love India inks. they dry quickly, so they add this protective layer to the paper, so it almost makes it versatile. Like, you could use it on any type of paper, even thin paper, I believe, which I'm going to be testing on this new sketchbook that I recently got to see how it works, how well that works. Yeah, I'm not getting the right color here. And I think that's because I don't have any brown involved. No. Beyond that. Shout out to Pretzel, man. I love this this playlist that they got going on. It's excellent. So this is a little bit of brown mixed in there, and I think it's kind of closer because what was going on was very neonish. Don't mind it. Kind of like it, but the goal here is to get better at mixing. So if I eye it, I want to be able to just do it right faster. I gotta favor this song. Hold on. Aquiril? Is that what it's called? Aquiril by Nopi. Nopi? I don't know. I don't know what that... I'm guessing that's how you say it with that accent on top of it. Nopi. Sounds like gnocchi. Like gnocchi. I don't know, man. I don't know. Not quite there yet. What is this color, man? It's the little dots that throw me off. It's like blue dots with yellow and green. And white. Maybe I need more white here. This is going to be a pretty it's going to be a pretty great week, actually, because tomorrow Doom Patrol is coming out. So for those of you who have been following it along with me, who've been watching it as well, the new season is coming out tomorrow. I'm hyped about that. Can't wait to see what kind of creativity they come up with. Not quite there yet. Reveal yourself, color. What are you? You're kind of yellow, but you're kind of green. Oh boy. I might sound frustrated, but I'm actually really enjoying it. Spend a little time trying to study it. I'm going to show you guys what's going on over here. Ooh, carefully, because I got some combined colors here, but yeah, basically I'm just like mixing it all over here. And before, when I got this palette, I was just like, wow, there's so much space. What do you need all this space for? Now look at this. Now like it's really being utilized completely, if not demanding more space. But yeah, I'm just kind of playing around with it here. Gonna give you guys a little glimpse into it because I'm spending so much time there. Might as well. Trying to capture the likeness of that color. Dare I put a little bit of blue? I'm gonna add a hint of blue. All right, let's see what we got here. And I kind of have to work quickly because it dries out pretty fast. No, that's so green. Way too green. I think this is more accurate. I'm thinking probably when I start adding the other green, you know, the shade, it's going to start look more or similar to the original. So those of you who have been following along with some of my advice, I would often say, like, you know, don't hold the pencil too close to the tip. Now, it's not really the case for when it comes to the brush, because with the brush, if you hold it to the side, right, in order for you to be able to hold it further away, when you hold it like that, you end up making really broad brush strokes. You know, because more of the brush is actually touching the surface as opposed to just the tip when it comes to the pencil. You know, no matter what angle you hold it in, if it's a mechanical pencil or even if it's like a regular pencil, it could only get so thick. Whereas with this brush, that's not the case. And there's paint all over it. It's not just like the tip of it. So you can get really thick lines that you didn't intend to make. So in order for it to be comfortable, you know, you do want to hold it closer towards the tip. Otherwise, it has to turn to something like this in order to get really thin lines, and that can get pretty uncomfortable if you're working for a while. Adjust to what the situation needs, but your default should want to be like at further away from the tip. When it comes to, especially when it comes to drawing, when it comes to sketching things out, it gives you pretty good scope of vision on what's going on. It's not being blocked by your hand, which is what I'm dealing with right now. My hand is blocking the vision for everything else. Oh man, green is so overpowering. But I guess it fits into the idea of light to dark. You know, if you're going from black to white, you know, if you put black paint and then you try to add more white to it, you're going to be adding a lot of white in order to, like, let's say, get more of a gray. Whereas if you go from white and you add a little bit of dark color to it or black color to it, you're going to use less paint, and you're going to do less work in general trying to get it to that color. No, I could already see how it's not going to work. So remember, light to dark. Thought I had it. I want to say it's like more yellow than it is green. I had it here. This pillar looks right. This, on the other hand, does not. Just gonna work directly on the canvas with these colors. There's also this line right here. I'm gonna say it's more yellow. Yeah, this is more accurate. I'm going to stop right there with that pillar because I'm slowly turning it like a pale brown. You can see how quickly it dries. Like originally it was much greener. And just in a matter of minutes, I was able to do multiple coats and completely cover it. And yet nothing on the other side. This is excellent paper. I'm so bummed that Canson hasn't returned my email. Because I really would want to find a large drawing pad of this type of paper. All right, moving on to the next. I'm going to say this is going to be less of a battle. Oh no, the blue seeped into the purple. Well, I don't really have that much purple anyway on any of these. All right, let's see if I got this. Where do I test this out? I'm gonna test this out right here. I'm gonna say too green. Way too green. Yeah, I've decided that I'm just not going to bother with details. I'm just going to cover them up and then come back with black ink. And redefine them. Nope. That's too pale. Nope, nope, nope. Color mixing is proving itself to be very problematic. Probably going to take me several tries until I get this down. I'm going to say several streams, not even tries. Kind of have to, I think, approach this like a science, like really pay attention to how I'm mixing the colors, you know, and like calculate how much I'm dipping my brush into what, so that way I could just reproduce that color over and over and over again. But what I was getting at before was, what I'm gonna need to do is just use up all these vials, these like little squeeze bottles, get new ones, and then when I'm creating these colors, just pour it into these little vials, or just buy separate ones, like small ones, so that I could reuse them for other colors. Like clean them out and then use other colors inside of it. It doesn't look terrible. I'm not thrilled with the fact that I'm not able to capture like the exact color, because I really want to get that. I used water here to mix this one to retain the detail in the background to some degree, because even if I was to, let's say, switch up the order, like I would do pencils, then error here with my drawing. This is supposed to be a lot straighter. Continue on as the stage. Even if I was to change up the order and I was to do like pencil first, then color over the pencil, I'd still need to see the detail for the inking. Or at least make it visible for that. Already dried. Amazing. Okay, so it seems like brown is almost unavoidable. Like, you have to add a little bit of brown in order to get this like yellow green. Like, this time it turned out pretty good. So I can't make this color that I'm seeing without brown. It's absolutely essential. Just filling it in. Not even worrying about it. But yeah, it's like opaque enough for me to be able to see where the detail is going to be. Otherwise, just having to go in between each and one of those like black lines to fill in the color and avoid that like that white border, I don't think it's worth it. I think it's better to just fill them in, color that area, and then just come back and redo them. That's probably less time consuming. Guess I'm not fully done with this blue green. Ooh, water. Water damage. Where's my trusty rag? All right, gonna have to redo it. It's dried for the most part. Some green, a pinch of blue. And a lot of white. Brown there to dull out the vibrancy. This is a personal detail right here. This isn't part of the original because I didn't measure out this panel right compared to the original. And like, that space shouldn't have to exist. In fact, his hand is more, it's higher, you know, depending on how you want to look at it. Either the pillar is lower and the hand is within that pillar, or the arm is supposed to be higher. It's like entire figure is supposed to be taller. Alright, it's okay. I'm gonna move on to, looks like everything as far as the background is concerned is done. Or rather the pillars. So now I have to move on to another background that has like a really pale blue. But I'm gonna say that blue also has a bit of black. So a pinch of black there, mix it in, and add more blue. And what that should give me is like this almost sky blue color. Is that good? I think more white. Yeah, that's more like it. All right, at least we're getting something down immediately, which is this blue. Not very complicated. Probably gonna want to do a little bit of research after this, like, and see if there are any YouTube videos that show how people used to color traditionally back in the day. Like, I know what the procedure is like, you know, the technical procedure, but actually seeing people like colorists in that time color their panels. I mean, I guess acetate, like the way I'm doing it, I don't think is the way they did it. Had acetate paper, so that allowed the opportunity for mistakes to be made. Or rather, like, let's say this is acetate paper, right? And I'm gonna say the inks were on top of this. It's confusing. Like, yeah, probably they had the pencil, right? So they had the pencil work. Then they used acetate paper on top of it to ink it. And then they had acetate paper in between the inks and the pencils. And that's where they laid the colors. And then they would just like flip the acetate paper on top of the color to see, to make sure that it matches. That's my guess. You know, that's my shot in the dark interpretation of how they used to do it back then. But yeah, I'm gonna have to do a little digging, see if I could find some sort of videos that show some demonstration. Drop of water there. It's an interesting choice, actually. Like, I wouldn't think that sky blue would be something used. I wonder if that was like a color composition choice, like they just liked this combination of like blue and greens and purples that are coming up, and yellows. But before the stream is over, I'm gonna fix this yellow right here. It should be more vibrant. A little too dull on my end. White. Oh, it dried so quick. It's super white now. Dude, come on. No. Too white. I'm going to lend it off to other sections. Spread it around. Thank you. think this is the only time I don't mind that an app is learning from my likes. Before I would be like, no, you know, you're not getting it. But with Pretzel, considering the stream and such, I'm glad that it's choosing music that I enjoy. Okay, I'm gonna leave this alone. I'm gonna leave the background alone. And I'm gonna start with the purples. Alright, after this one, just gonna fix this area right here. It's too, compared to the original, it's too vibrant. I dipped in a little bit of water, like I barely touched it with the brush, so that way I give the white some opacity. So like when I paint over this blue, it's not going to be super white since the blue is dried. And it seems to work. It's actually working pretty nicely. Now I'm gonna get into the purples. So I'm gonna clean my brush to get all that gunk off of it. And I'm gonna start with this guy right here. Oh man, I think this turned blue. We'll see. Nope, more white. More white and a drop of water. Drop of water as like a medium. Okay, maybe like a tiny droplet of black. One of the reasons why I'm using more water now is because the white that I have is slowly starting to like get thicker. That's more like it. So two things I was able to get right, which is the blue, the very simple blue, and the color of their robes. But now that I'm like looking at it, I'm like, is there red? Is there a hint of red in there? Challenge. And here I'm gonna go for more water. I'm gonna try to make it opaque. Come back to it. Because there's way too much fine detail there. It's just hard to believe that that inks were done on acetate paper. Because the original, right, like the original drawing itself was on paper, obviously it was like on comic book paper. That was the pencils. Then they would ink on top of it. And then they would put acetate paper on top to color it. Or did they have to like re-ink with acetate paper? And that way they can color the originals and then put the inks on top of those colors. I don't know. It's really challenging to think about. Like one thing I know for sure is like the comic book paper had both. It had ink and the pencil work. So if that was the case, how do they retain the inks? Like how you're seeing it here, like super, the inks are very vibrant. You know, it's not like what you're seeing here, which is like washed out. Yeah, I'm gonna have to do some digging. All right, everybody, with that said, I am going to call it a night for tonight. I hope you enjoyed the special intro for tonight. I hope you enjoyed the special stream. I will be uploading it tonight so you guys can rewatch both of those deep cuts animations. And if you guys did enjoy this content, just make sure you remember to hit the like and subscribe button. They're both greatly appreciated. Once again, thanks to all the YouTube subscribers. You guys are great. I'm happy you guys are enjoying this. And I will see you guys tomorrow. Tomorrow is going to be Figure Drawing Basics at 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time and the project stream at 9. So I'll see you there.